I am Dr. Ramakumar. I am working as an associate consultant cardiologist at MS Ramaiah Narayana Heart Center. We have with us Dr. Nagamalesh today, who is a senior interventional cardiologist as well as the head of heart failure management at MS Ramaiah Narayana Heart Center, Bangalore. Welcome, sir.
Yeah. I think today we are discussing about a very important topic, that is heart failure. So we have a lot of, usually our patients will have a lot of doubts about heart failure, heart attack, how to manage. So we'll be discussing about this.
Right, sir. So let's start off from the basics. So what basically is, what do you mean by heart failure? So what are the signs and symptoms? When would a patient come to us, or what symptoms can they have?
Heart failure basically when heart is not pumping enough blood to the body, that is called heart failure. Or it can pump blood, enough blood with very high pressure inside the heart, both considered as heart failure. So heart failure is due to weak heart or weak muscles in the heart. That can be due to a disease of the heart muscle itself, or due to heart attack. Heart will get damaged, the heart muscle get damaged and leads to heart failure. So when somebody has got heart failure, they have problem in early phase, difficulty in walking. When they walk, they feel breathless, or they feel breathless when they lie down flat, or they can feel breathless after some time, after 2 hours of sleep, and they get up in the night with the breathless. Or can be very acute phase, like patient rushed to hospital with severe breathing problem. And the chronic phase, they can have edema in the leg, edema in the abdomen, loss of weight. So those things can be in a long-term chronic cases.
So this breathing difficulty of sudden onset, can it also behave like asthma, sir? Is there a difference between the two?
Yes. So we used to call it as cardiac asthma for all these patients. There is a difference. The asthma is a seasonal, and they feel breathless and they take nebulization, they feel better. Or sometimes it can be very severe also. But heart failure is they feel breathless and they lie down, or they feel breathless after 2 hours of sleep, and there'll be edema in the leg, edema in the abdomen. So there's some difference, sometimes very difficult to differentiate, but in hospital we can differentiate. For patients, sometimes may be difficult to differentiate these two.
This is purely on examination, or there are any blood tests by any alterations which
can help? 90% of the patients we can make out with clinical examination, but when you have doubt, so we can send blood tests like NT-proBNP, that will be elevated in case of heart failure and not in case of respiratory disease
like
bronchial asthma.
Okay, right. So now I'm sure your patient spectrum would be a wide spectrum. So this heart failure, at what age group can it affect, sir?
See, heart failure can be from the birth to any age. Usually in advanced age, above 60 years, it start increasing, and in a old age the incidence of heart failure is high. But at the same time, not that you don't see in middle age, so it is seen in all age group from birth to 100 years, any age a patient can have.
So having understood now at what ages it, since it can present at all ages, do causes also differ?
Causes also differ. It can be congenital heart disease, can be valvular heart disease. Valves are get blocked at birth, and from the birth they can have blockage and have heart failure. Sometimes aortic disease can also have heart failure at birth. Valvular heart disease in early ages, like 20 years, 25 years or 15 years, leakages in the valve because of the rheumatic fevers. All this can, all spectrum of heart disease, the end result of all these diseases are heart failure basically. So the commonest what we see is a dilated cardiomyopathy, that is heart get dilated without any reason. known reason, basically. There'll be some reason, but we don't know what exactly the reason. Two, patient who had a heart attack in the past, that heart get dilated and can have heart failure. So what we are seeing now, the commonest one more reason, common reason is those who have uncontrolled hypertension. That is most preventable, and you know, and it should be done by all doctors to control BP so that these patients won't get into heart failure in future. Especially heart get they'll get a LBH or bulky heart, and you know, sometimes in the hospital also we ignore, it's just LBH. It's not just LBH. These patients can be land up in heart failure with a serious problem in future. So that's the reason they should not avoid taking hypertensive medications. So some people with 150, 100 BP, they say, you know, I don't want to take medicine. I want to wait for some more days or some more years. So the heart get damaged, heart will become bulky and they'll get heart failure in future. So they should start early antihypertensive medication so that they'll not get into heart failure in future.
Now, you mentioned just a bit earlier that heart attack can lead to heart failure. So what is the difference between the two? Is there a difference?
Yes, there is a lot of difference between these two. The cause of heart failure is heart attack. So basically in heart attack, the blood vessels which supply blood to heart muscle which get occluded, and it's just like gangrene to your hand. So heart muscle get damaged if you don't open these vessels within 6 hours. So sometimes they come to hospital but they don't agree for the angioplasty, or they don't reach hospital, they think it's a gastritis, they sit at home. If they come after 6 hours, all these muscles get damaged and land up in heart failure. But heart failure is, as we discussed so far, this is the major difference between these two conditions.
So basically there is lack of blood supply, there is death of heart muscle.
Heart muscle.
So there is not enough muscle to perform work which is normally required by the body.
Yes.
I think that should summarize. So now, having learnt about what are the causes and the age of presentation, what are our treatment options that are available today, sir? Is it only medicines, or is there anything further to it?
See, what I feel is the heart failure, the most important part of heart failure therapy is prevention. Because once they get into heart failure, the long-term prognosis is not very great, and the cost of therapy also very high. So what is available today is extremely expensive. Maybe it may not be available for many of our population. The most important therapy for heart failure is prevention. That is BP control, blood sugar control, exercise, prevention of obesity, low salt intake from the beginning. So these are the few things. If you follow strictly, you can prevent majority of heart failure. So as for the treatment of heart failure is concerned, once a patient gets into heart failure, we have medical management, that is giving medicines to patients, and also lifestyle modification, what I said now. And these are the major things every hospital follow. So here we also follow, especially those who have little low pumping. Even after going home, you try to follow up and manage this patient so that they don't come back to hospital for admission. So we try to avoid admission. This is called home care therapy for heart failure. So this is very promising, actually, to do things to avoid a lot of economic loss to patients so that we can prevent admissions and manage on outpatient basis rather than every other day getting into hospital and spending money in the hospital.
Could you elaborate on how exactly this home-based therapy is helping patients and what is their contribution to that?
See, what we are doing in our hospital as part of our heart failure program, we have heart failure nurse which is dedicated to take care of all heart failure patients. Anybody who is diagnosed as heart failure, they'll be registered, and we are doing counseling for these patients, including exercise, diet, and also talk about what is heart failure. The person should know what is heart failure, then only will try to manage better. If it doesn't know what is heart failure, you don't care about that. So we try to make them understand what is the condition he's suffering from and why he's getting into this problem. Once we do that, we follow up this patient from home. We ask them to send a regular weight measurement and symptoms. So they all send it through smartphone to us. If anything, if they start gaining weight more than 2 kg, if the symptoms are increasing, we ask them to come back to hospital. We try to manage them on outpatient basis so that they don't, see, if you leave this patient for another 2-3 days, they'll come to ICU. You know how expensive ICUs are. So we can avoid that. We try to cut down that and try to manage these patients on outpatient basis.
Right. So can you give us some clinical or pointers to a layman what would suggest that? I think you had already specified.
So one is, the fluid restriction. So usually on patient to patient basis, we restrict fluid somewhere between 1 liter, sometime 800 ml or 1.5 liters. So one is the fluid restriction is very important. That include all fluids. Second is salt restriction. So each gram of salt can hold 200 ml of fluid in the body. So if you keep on eating more salt, our medicines won't work properly. So important to avoid admission is to avoid salt. So you should not eat excess salt. The third thing is to take a regular medication. Fourth is to monitor himself, his symptoms and weight measurement and symptoms. If anything, you should report to heart failure nurse so that you can take initiation to prevent admission.
Right. So another very important thing that I think patients would have a doubt about is now that their heart is not functioning at optimum level. So how much of exercise activity can they take and what is the role of cardiac rehab?
See, the most of the patients who come to hospital and they say you walk every day, you do some whatever we teach them, the exercise, they try to avoid because everybody have a fear of getting into some complication after doing exercise. Okay. Basically, whatever research is done on exercise and heart failure, the exercise is the one which prevents the readmission and also sudden cardiac death because it will increase the vagal tone and prevent the lot of complication of heart failure. So exercise is one of the important therapy in heart failure. So we have heart failure rehab in this hospital where all these patients are put into rehab specialist under the cardiology, heart failure cardiologist supervision, and we advise them how much exercise they have to do it and what, how much safe for them to do exercise. So these are the very important in heart failure patients.
Right. So I think those are very valuable insight which Dr. Nagamalesh has provided. Now moving forward, sir, you said that heart failure basically means that the heart is functioning at a suboptimal level. So what would you call as normal and when do you say it's suboptimal? Are all these patients who have suboptimal function the same or is there a grading for these patients?
Yes, see, we have to in general to be very superficially explaining these things. Patient can have heart failure with normal pumping function. Heart is little stiff, so it cannot relax properly, so this patient also can have heart failure. Coming to people who got less pumping, they can be mild, they can be moderate or severe. Usually those who have less than 40, 40 to 30 and less than 30, we classify them mild, moderate, severe. So mild heart failure or mild LV dysfunction, it can progress to severe if you don't take care of them, if you don't properly treat these patients. So these are the early phase we can prevent them progressing into major heart failure.
Okay, and is there some entity called as advanced heart failure where patients require something more than medicines?
Yes.
What is your take on that?
Yes, see, heart failure, as I told you, those who have heart failure, this patient can be treated by easily with medicines. If somebody who is not responding to your regular medicines or device therapy, like CRT, these patients are called advanced heart failure or refractory heart failure. Means the usual therapy we have for heart failure, they are not responding. And
by usual therapy, what all are you looking at?
One is medicine, other is device therapy. Suppose if they don't respond, and also the lifestyle modification.
Right.
If they don't respond to this and they are persistently in heart failure, it's called refractory heart failure, or nowadays we call it as advanced heart failure, because we have some other treatment for them too. There's a reason we don't call it as refractory now. So it's called advanced heart failure. So once they get into advanced heart failure, their long-term prognosis is extremely poor unless you do some specialized therapy. So advanced heart failure require advanced therapy.
Could you elaborate on the advanced therapy that is available at MS Ramaiah Narayana Heart Center?
See, advanced therapy, what is available today is, one is heart transplant, second is artificial heart, third is palliative care, like removing fluid from the body, keep patient comfortable. If somebody is not suitable for these two, we have to keep him comfortable. So we have a palliative therapy by doing few things like ultrafiltration. What we have here, we have done few patients ultrafiltration. It's not a dialysis. It just removes fluid from the body without disturbing electrolytes. It's a little expensive procedure because that circuit is expensive, but it's very effective. You can remove even 6 to 8 liters of fluid in 24 to 48 hours. So it's very effective therapy for those who are advanced heart failure not responding to regular therapy. And we have other two, like artificial heart and transplant. Those who are eligible can undergo this type of therapy.
How different is this? You mentioned that ultrafiltration, you can remove just the fluid. So how different is this from dialysis? Is there risk that is involved? Yes. With dialysis, do they have to have a permanent catheter, or could you elaborate on that, sir?
See, both needs catheter to draw blood from the body and go through the filtration. But the difference between these two is, even with the low pressure, we can do ultrafiltration. If pressure is low, we cannot do dialysis. And the electrolyte shift and electrolyte imbalance and other complication is very high with dialysis. Ultrafiltration you can do with a low pressure, and there's not much fluid shift in the body, so less complications.
So
but only problem is, we need to have near normal creatinine level. If creatinine level, that means renal function, kidney function is very badly affected, then we can't do ultrafiltration. He has to go for dialysis.
So you said that creatinine is an important indicator with regard to what therapies you can offer. So what other organs can get involved with advanced heart failure, sir?
In a advanced heart failure, patient can have kidney problem, or they can have liver issues, because once the blood flow is low, whole body can affect, even brain can be affected. So the whole body can affect at the end. So because of the low blood supply.
Right. So now, having understood about what heart failure is, what are the signs and symptoms, what are the management strategies that are available presently, then we've moved on to advanced heart failure. Now, in addition to the low pumping that is associated with heart failure, what other abnormalities in the heart can accompany somebody who has a heart failure, sir? Can they have differences in their electrical system, disturbances in their electrical system?
Yes, yes. They can have, see, these heart failure patients, especially those who have very low pumping function, they can have two issues. One is the pumping is low. Because of that, gradually the pump function can come down. Sudden is sudden cardiac death. That is because of the abnormal beating of the heart. The patient can have sudden cardiac death. So this can be prevented by optimally managing, doing exercise, and also we have device therapy like ICD. So there's a defibrillator fitted to the patient that can continuously monitor the patient, and in case if something happening like that, it can give shock before he realize, it'll give a therapy. That is wonderful device available today, people can make use of it. The only issue is it's slightly expensive and it's an invasive this one, but once it's done, it will come for a very long time. So it can be used to prevent the sudden cardiac death among heart failure patient.
So are these services available at your center,
yes,
sir?
Yes, I think it's available everywhere. I think this is very commonly done. ICD and CRT is commonly done procedure. The only thing is we have to choose right patient for both these devices. One is ICD and also CRT. So especially coming to CRT. So that is
CRT?
A resynchronization therapy. One is there is an electrical desynchronization in the heart. We have to synchronize the heart so that whatever possible we can improve the heart function so that patient can have a comfortable life. So this patient selection is very important. Not everybody will respond to this. People with advanced heart failure may not respond to this type of therapy. Or people with not in advanced heart failure may not get benefit from transplant or LVAD. So we should choose right patient for this therapy. Even though the spectrum of therapy is available, choosing a right patient to right therapy is our responsibility. That's what I feel.
So are the two devices different, CRT and
two devices
ICD?
Are different, yeah. One is to,
what is the difference between
one
the
is
two?
To prevent sudden cardiac death, it will give shock. Another is to synchronize the heart. So now the device available together, it can synchronize the heart and it can give shock also if it's required.
Okay, so these devices, they prevent the shocks or they work only if a need arises?
Yeah, it can to some extent prevent shock also. It can initially, if somebody is getting arrhythmia, it can have a pacing therapy and it can revert that to normal. If that is not happening, within a few seconds it will give shock and prevent the sudden cardiac death.
So if a patient with heart failure, he has this device, does he still need to take his medicines?
Yes, he has to take his medicine to prevent heart failure. This is only an addition to medicine. Medicines is the first thing to do. Medicine, drinking less water, salt control, lifestyle, all this is a standard thing you should do it. Along with that, this will give additional help to prevent heart failure.
Okay. During our course of conversation, you mentioned something called a sudden cardiac death, sir. Could you elaborate on that, please? What
yes.
is it? And
yeah, sudden cardiac death is when patients get arrhythmia or when the heart rate goes up very high. So heart cannot pump, it start just fibrillating and there is no pump function, and within 3 minutes patient cannot, you know, come out of this phase and they'll succumb to this disease. So to prevent, we have to act fast. Even if you keep one a cardiologist with you, he may not be able to save you, but ICD can prevent. It can give shock and bring back to normal. So there are many lucky people who survived because of this device.
So, in your patient selection criteria, roughly whom would you advise to undergo this sort of procedure? Because you mentioned about mild LV dysfunction, moderate and severe LV dysfunction. So,
yeah, usually moderate LV, above moderate LV dysfunction is the one we select patients. And also there are some ECG abnormality we take into consideration. Symptoms we can take into consideration. So, all based on this, we select patients for both device therapy.
Right. So we saw that what therapies are available for advanced heart failure. Now, suppose a patient has been diagnosed with heart failure. He's undergone a CRT. Initially, he showed promising response, but later his response was not maintained and he continued to worsen. So such kind of patient, I'm sure you would have had with your practice.
Yes.
So what are the treatment therapies that you can offer to these patients, sir?
So those patients who have low heart pumping, whether those who are on CRT, that is resynchronization therapy, or ICD, or those who don't have any of these and on the medical management, what we do in our center is we put them on cardiopulmonary exercise test. That is a functional assessment test which is tell us how is his prognosis for next 1 year. Not all patients with the low pumping needs transplant, but all transplants will be done for the patient who got low pumping function. So if the we call it as VO2 max, or in a cardiopulmonary exercise test, we assess and found that his long-term prognosis is not good. So we have some fixed criteria for this. So not able to explain to the general public. So we have fixed criteria. Once they meet this fixed criteria, then we recruit them for transplant or well-bad.
Is this the same as the angiogram which commonly people talk about? Is there a difference?
It is exercise. Basically, it is a treadmill test. So we make them walk on the treadmill and we fix a mask. In the mask, we have a sensor which can detect how much carbon dioxide is exhaling and how much oxygen is taking in. Based on this, there's a ratio. And the based on this, we basically assess his functional capacity and advise transplant.
Now, suppose this you assess a patient and you find that he's a suitable candidate for transplant. How do you take it forward, sir? What is the protocol you'll follow?
Yeah. Once we found this patient is suitable for transplant, we try to talk to patient and their family members and pros and cons about the transplant, how important in maintaining the heart, not just taking the heart, somebody else's heart and transplanting it, but managing this for a long term is very important. It is respect to the person who's donated heart also. So we try to understand their motivation, their interest, and how they can manage this heart for a long term. And once they are okay with all this, so we have a regular counseling session for them. Once they attend one or two counseling session and we register with JSK, that is Jeevana Sarthakate. So once we register, then you'll go through the panel of tests, including a pressure in the heart and the cardiopulmonary exercise test, and all other panel of tests is available for the transplant, like immunological test. So once we do all this, you'll start waiting for the transplant. So once his waiting list comes up and heart is available, and we transplant these patients.
Okay. Is there any interim device or something which you can put in while the patient is waiting for, suppose he decompensates or becomes bad, is there something to bridge till they undergo the transplant, sir?
Yeah, if the patient, we do everything and send them home and is waiting for transplant, is fine, is basically is carry less risk for transplant. But people who cannot go out of hospital or continuously deteriorating, PP is low, no urine output, and they're suffering from multi-organ dysfunction. These patients, we have to put them on the temporary left ventricle assist device or artificial heart or biventricle assist device to bridge them for transplant. So these patients will recover on this machine. It is basically heart, by both hearts are supported. So somebody, you don't require heart to leave after that. So heart can stop also, no problem. So patient can go on this for about 1 to 3 months, and once heart is available, we transplant and then we remove this machine.
What is your experience with the left ventricular assist device? Can you share maybe one or two cases with us?
Yeah, we had one patient who was admitted in Uttar Pradesh, one place in Uttar Pradesh, and he was in ICU, intubated, he was on dialysis, he was young, 40 years old. So we got a call from there that is very sick, they are not able to manage, and we airlifted this patient from this is a Jhansi from UP, and we put them on a biventricular assist device. He waited and all his organs are recovered, then we transplanted after 1.5 months, and now it is almost like 1 year and is doing well. So these are some examples of surviving even after this such a major medical illness.
Right, sir. So suppose now the patient has undergone a transplant, what about their post-transplant life? Can they get back to their normal life?
Yes, most of them can get back to their normal life. Usually their 5-year survival is 85% and 10-year survival is 75%. So these patient can go back to normal, their lifestyle will become absolutely normal, and also they can go back to their work. So usually after 3 to 6 months, when their health improves and all the organ functions become normal and their immunosuppression is less. So this patient can go back to their normal life. Some people, they have started working, a few, one or two got married even after transplant. So and kids went back to school. So that's the happiness you
must be very heartwarming.
Yes,
right.
You feel even after transplant.
And after that, how frequently do they have to come back for a follow-up with their transplant physician?
Usually we ask them to come every month in the first year, but after 1 year, they have to come once in 3 months for a regular check-up.
And I'm sure with a transplant, they must take some precautions.
Yes,
so
they have to take
some few tips which
yes.
you could.
Yeah, the most important is they should regular with the hospital. Any intercurrent illness, they should report to the transplant cardiologist, and especially if there is an infection, flu, and we usually give regularly vaccination that they should take, and medicine should be very regular. They should not stop any medicine for any reason without consulting us, and there are some protocol evaluation regularly we do, like biopsies, angiograms, so that they should undergo, they should not refuse. So once, usually that these sick patients, when they are, once they are fine after 3 months, they start neglecting because they feel that they are fine. So they should not neglect this. More than doing a transplant, the post-op is very, very important because this is what make them live for longer period.
Yeah, so we had a very comprehensive insight into heart failure and the management of heart failure and the services that are available currently today at MS Ramaiah Narayana Heart Center. We had with us Dr. Nagamalesh. Thank you so much, sir, for providing such valuable detail for all our patients. Thank you.